In Isaiah chapter 11, and we're going to start in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1. Yeah, we're good here. All right, thanks. There you go, man. Starting in verse 1, "And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots." Now he's talking about Jesus being coming from the lineage of David, King David. And he says, and look at verse 2, "And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him." Now what have we been talking about on Sundays? Holy Ghost and fire. Learning about the Holy Ghost, learning about what the Lord has for us to, and an understanding of this. So I kind of want to highlight one aspect of the Holy Ghost tonight, and then give you some things I believe will help you kind of relay some things that's been going on with me that'll help. He says here, "And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth." And I'm going to go ahead and stop there. So he says that the Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him. Now Jesus actually quoted another scripture in Isaiah. If you look at Luke chapter 4, he says that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has anointed me to open the blind eyes, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, the opening of prisons to them that are bound. This is talking about the Spirit of the God that was on him. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Let's display that on the screen. Acts chapter 10, verse 38. Acts chapter 10, verse 38. How God, maybe we don't have it. Where?
It's not in their Bible.
Oh, Acts chapter 10, verse, what'd you say? Wrong verse. Acts chapter 10, verse 38. Is it there? Oh, you have it there. I don't have it here. That's the problem. Okay, now we do. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. Somebody say power.
Power.
Who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. God needs to be with us. He said, "I will never leave you. I will never forsake you." He is with us everywhere that we go. But how many of you know that we need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost? We need to be anointed by God through the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It's not just what happens when we become born again, but it's also this, it's not what happens inside, it's also this pouring on. See, I mean, when Jesus was walking amongst the crowd, the woman with the issue of blood touched the hem of his garment, and the Bible says that Jesus felt virtue go out of him. He's so full of the Holy Ghost. He's so full of the Spirit. He's so full of that he felt the power of God leave him. You know, and here's the great thing about it. The very hem of his garment, you know, I mean, that's the part that's getting all dirty, and that's the part that as they're walking, it's dusty and stuff like that. The hem of his garment may not be the most important part of his body, but there was just as much power in the most insignificant part as there was in his hands, as there was, you know, in his words, as there was in anything else that he did. You know, and the same thing is true. We are now the body of Christ. There is no insignificant parts in the body of Christ. All of us have that same power available to us, not just for those that are specially anointed to heal, but all of us. He said, "These signs shall follow them that believe. They will lay hands on the sick and they'll recover." All of us can be filled with the Holy Ghost and have this power operating in our life. All right, so back here at Isaiah chapter 11, so we start to see some aspects here of the Spirit of the Lord, of the Holy Ghost. And verse 2 again, "And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might," or power, "the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord." So these are just highlighting some different aspects of the Holy Ghost. But what I want to focus in on tonight for just a little bit is the Spirit of wisdom. The Spirit of wisdom. Turn with me over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, at the very first, he says, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant." So he's about to talk about spiritual gifts that come from the Holy Ghost. And then he goes on to say in verse 4, "Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of administrations, but the same Lord." Now go on down to verse 7, "But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man." Somebody say every man. Not some special men, but it's given to every man to profit everybody. Yeah. See, when you come to church or when you gather with believers, you bring something with you to benefit everybody else. We don't just come to church just to receive. We also come to give. Yeah. See, as Ephesians chapter 4 says, the body of Christ, we grow up into Him as each member connects with each other, and as there's a supply that comes out of each other, every joint supplies. Yeah. See, you have a supply. So he goes on to say, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom. The word of wisdom. To another, the word of knowledge. Well, what did we just see over here in Isaiah? He's the Spirit of wisdom. He's the Spirit of knowledge. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. To another, working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of spirits. To another, different kinds of tongues. And to another, the interpretation of tongues. But all these work that one and the self-same Spirit, dividing to every man severally as He wills. See? What needs to be done? What do you need in a situation? What do you need? He knows. What is the person that you're trying to minister to? What do they need? He knows. So He'll give you either a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge. Maybe they need a miracle. And maybe it's extraordinary what they need. And that's out of your normal faith zone, what you're able to believe for. But something comes on you and the Spirit of God super energizes your faith. And He just gives you that gift of supernatural faith in that moment to be bold and to declare and to speak, and all of a sudden, they're healed. But the word of wisdom, the word of wisdom. Turn with me over to Proverbs chapter 3. Proverbs chapter 3. Because what we need, well, we need all of it, but we certainly need wisdom to operate in this day and time. We need the wisdom of God. All right, now, in Proverbs chapter 3, it says in verse 13, "Happy is the man that finds wisdom, and the man that gets understanding. For the merchandise of it is better than the merchandise of silver, and the gain thereof than fine gold. She is more precious than rubies, and all things that you can desire are not to be compared to her." That's a pretty strong statement. Doesn't matter what you desire, what you want in life, he says, nothing can be compared to wisdom. Length of days is in her right hand, and in her left hand riches and honor. Now, length of days is different than long life. Long life is one thing, length of days is another thing. How many of you sometimes just can't seem to get it all done in a day? You just run out of time, you run out of time, you run out of time. Wisdom will show you how to get it done, and supernaturally those days will seem to lengthen. You'll get it all done in a day. The Bible says redeem the time.
That's right.
See? And the Spirit of God knows what you can, how you can navigate or how you can go through your day and how you can get everything done so that you can be at a place of peace, at a place of rest, and a place of joy, and you're not always trying to catch up or feel like that you are. length of days is in her right hand. So you don't need more time. What you need is wisdom. And in her left hand, riches and honor. Her ways, if you'll go her ways, if you'll let the spirit of wisdom lead you and guide you, her ways are ways of pleasantness. And all, somebody say all her paths are peace. All of them. Always be in a place of peace. Always be in a place of rest. She is a tree of life to them that lay hold upon her. And happy is everyone. Man, how many of you want to be happy? Experience happiness and joy. Happy is everyone that retains her, that holds on to her, that's letting her lead and guide. Let the spirit of wisdom. The Lord through wisdom, has founded the earth. By understanding has He established the heavens. By His knowledge, the depths are broken up and the clouds drop down the dew. So he's just talking, and he goes on, my son, this is just all great promises. Let them not depart from your eyes. Keep sound wisdom and discretion. So shall they be life unto your soul. And look, grace. Somebody say grace.
Grace
to your neck. Then you shall walk in your way safely, and your foot shall not stumble. When you lie down, you shall not be afraid. Yea, when you shall lie down, your sleep shall be sweet. Mm-hmm. How many of you need sweet sleep?
Yeah.
Here's the promise. Be not afraid of sudden fear, neither of the desolation of the wicked when it comes. Mm-hmm. For the Lord shall be your confidence and shall keep your foot from being taken.
Amen.
That's awesome. That's the spirit of wisdom and what He will do for each and every one of us. Now, we find that Jesus, as He was growing up as a child, the Bible says He grew in wisdom. He grew in stature and He grew in the grace of the Lord. Now, how do we tap into this wisdom for our lives? Practically, what does it look like? How do we flow in that? How do we access the spirit of wisdom? Well, the first thing that you got to understand is that wisdom comes through Jesus Christ. All right, turn with me. I believe it's 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I want to read this and then just share some things with you. Well, the whole thing is good, but in verse 19, he says, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? There's a lot of that happening in our world today. Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. What is he saying? He's saying as the world has increased in knowledge, as the world has increased in their scientific discoveries, as the world has increased in their own efforts and their own intellect, they have disconnected from God in this process. Now we've gotten so smart that we don't need God in the world. That's what he's talking about. They knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Praise God. All right, now he goes on to talk about it, but you see that in verse 27. So God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And the base things of the world and things which are despised has God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are. That no flesh, look at this, that no flesh should glory in His presence. Now this is a huge key. This is so important for ministers of the gospel, so important for Christians, because sometimes what I've seen is people like to take credit for their own miracles. Look at what my faith did.
Oh, yeah.
I believe God, and this is what I did. and I studied the Word, and I confessed, and I did all of these. And somewhere along the way, we've began to take credit for the miracles that God does in our life. Well, the Bible here says that no flesh should glory in His presence. I can't earn God's best in my life. I can't earn His love. I can't earn anything that He's given to me. I can't do it. So why should I look at my own effort or something that I've done to be the catalyst or the cause for God moving in my life? All I need to do is be at a place of believing what God has freely given to me. For by grace are you saved. Grace is the unmerited, undeserving love of God, favor of God in your life, apart from anything that you do. For by grace are you saved through faith. So what does that mean? What do I have to do? I believe that I can't do anything to earn it. I believe that God's given it to me freely. I trust in that. I know that whatever the situation is, I need the wisdom of God in my life. See? So now he says that no flesh should glory in his presence, but of him are you in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, he that glories, let him glory in the Lord. The wisdom that you need for today comes from him and him only. Amen. See. Us Americans can be very prideful sometimes. So, kind of to break this down practically, so yesterday I had a situation, some of you may have seen it on Facebook, but there's been some different people around here that have had flu symptoms. One in particular went to the doctor and she had walking pneumonia. I just said that pneumonia needs to walk on out, what it needs to do. But I haven't been sick in I don't know how long. And so yesterday afternoon, man, I started getting some chills. And you know what the first thing that the devil hit me with? Walking pneumonia. Oh, he'll sit there and hit you with the worst thought. Started getting chills, started coughing. It wasn't good at all. Jennifer had to go to school. I mean, here I am, I'm in the bed, I'm shivering. My temperature went to 102, 103 at one point. Now, I started praying about it. I started thinking about it. I said, God, I thank you that I'm healed by the stripes of Jesus. This isn't right. Now, one of the things that you have to be cautious about in that situation, and I've seen Christians do this over and over again, is when they get sick, they want to know where they opened the door. All right, where did I open the door for this to come in? And you start going down the checklist. Am I in strife? Did I do this? Did I do that? In other words, you're looking again at your own effort. Okay? And so if you look hard enough, you're going to find an area that you're not perfect in. Newsflash, you're not perfect in every area. So what you're doing is you'll find yourself getting into self-condemnation. And the Bible says that if our heart condemns us, then we will not have confidence towards God. But there is therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. See, he loves me, he heals me simply because of his love for me, not because of me doing everything exactly right. Amen. All right, so the first thing I did not, as I'm looking back, I'm not going to figure out where the door was open. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the blood. I'm going to go to what Jesus said. All right, now, I could have laid there all night long and just, been pretty pitiful and called Jennifer, come help me. I could have done all of that, but you know what? I said, no, I am not going to go through this. I am not going to have this pneumonia, this flu, whatever this thing is that's trying to attach itself to my body. So I began praying. Now, here's the thing. We'll talk about this some later as we get into some things about the Holy Ghost. But the Holy Ghost is a spirit of wisdom. He's the spirit of counsel. He's the spirit of might. He's our comforter. He leads us and he guides us into all truth. Now, how do I access that? All right, the Bible says that he searches all the deep things of God. The Bible says that when I speak in tongues, that I am building myself up and I'm speaking the hidden mysteries of God. I'm speaking the hidden wisdom of God. So what I started doing is you know, amongst all the chills and amongst the numerous showers and all that kind of stuff, is I'm thanking God. Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus that I am healed by the stripes of Jesus. Sickness doesn't have a right to get into my body in the name of Jesus. So Lord, I just receive that in Jesus' name. And then I just start praying in the Spirit. I start praying in tongues. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I just thank you. What am I doing? I'm saying, Lord, if there's anything I need from a wisdom standpoint, let me know. If I need to know something. Well, he started giving me some instructions on some things to do. But as I was praying, and I was walking around my bedroom and just praying, I heard this. I heard righteousness and judgment. He executes righteousness and judgment. Now, that's not a scripture that I normally think about. I don't even know where that scripture is. But it started coming up. It's not something I've studied. I don't even know that I've ever studied it. But I started hearing the Lord and righteousness and judgment. So I went and searched for where's there a scripture about righteousness and judgment. And so he took me over to Psalm 103. Psalm 103, look at this. Psalm 103, verse 6. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. Wow. Now, I'm thinking, wow, that's... And he starts talking to me about that. But then I thought, wait a minute, I know Psalm 103. I don't usually read this far. But let's go back to the beginning, because I know this, the first five by heart. Bless the Lord, O my soul. And all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals how many? All your diseases, all of them, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness. He crowns you, and I was just thinking, yesterday was Valentine's Day. He crowns me with his love, his loving kindness. That was a great scripture for Valentine's Day. He crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. He satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. That's usually as far as I go. But then the next verse, the Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. Now, the application of this in the Old Testament is regarding when the rich oppress the poor. When the rich oppress the poor, and God doesn't like it when the rich oppress the poor. But there's an application, what the Lord was showing me in the New Covenant. Jesus came to establish his kingdom here on the earth. He came preaching the kingdom of God. The Bible says that I am an ambassador of his kingdom. We're children of light. We have been translated, Colossians says, we've been moved from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. Now, a kingdom isn't necessarily a geographical place in the sense of it's got borders and all that. Kingdom is all of that that's set up by its citizenship and the rules and the laws and all of those things that make that up. And there's a king. King Jesus. Amen. All right, now, we have this debate that's going on in our country right now about those that come in illegally, those that come in and don't go through our normal processes as a, you know, as an immigrant from another country. And so now, the big debate is those that are coming here and trying to go around our laws and trying to get in here illegally. To the point that even, you know, it's in the courts and all of that. Well, here's the truth of the matter. Nobody outside of our country has any constitutional rights, because only citizens of this country have the rights of the Constitution that's afforded to them. So a Russian, a person from China, a person from Mexico, whatever, they can't go to the courts and say, I have a constitutional right to this because they're not a citizen of our country. Okay, makes sense. I don't have a constitutional right when it comes to Mexico and other places like that. I just don't. Sickness does not have a constitutional right to exist in my body. It is an illegal alien.
Yes.
It is trying to come in into a place that doesn't have a right to.
Right.
See?
Right.
The Bible says that the scepter of thy kingdom, talking about Jesus in Hebrews chapter 1, he says the scepter of thy kingdom is righteousness. So when it says that God executes righteousness and judgment for all of those that are oppressed, all right, a judge enforces the law. A judge enforces kingdom principles. So when we connect with it via faith, when we say, Lord, I believe this, and we rest in Him and we allow Him to do the work, then what I started saying is sickness doesn't have a right to be in my body, but it's illegal. And God executes righteousness and judgment on this thing that's trying to oppress me. He's the one that does it. I'm not the one that's trying to push it out, to reject it, and all of that. I'm resting in what He has decreed in His kingdom, and I'm part of that kingdom, and darkness can't have a part of that. See? What did that do for me? You know, why? What did that do? Why did I need that wisdom? Why was it that the Lord wanted me to get a hold of that? Because what He wanted me to do was connect with something on a concrete level that would just energize my faith, that would energize what I believe. That was like, oh yeah, this is exactly. No, I got mad. No, sickness, you don't have a right into my body. See, this happened a number of years ago. I started having gallbladder problems. And I knew what it was, but I just tried to ignore it. And then finally Jennifer said, look, you are keeping me up at night with your moaning and your groaning. If you wake me up again, I'm taking you to the emergency room. I'm like, sure, whatever. 2 o'clock in the morning, my worst attack yet. I'm moaning, I'm groaning. She goes, all right, get up, get dressed. I'm like, what are you talking about? She said, we're going to the emergency room. I'm tired of not sleeping. Now, this is before she got an understanding of grace and love. Her concern was for her sleeping. It really wasn't for me. She said, I knew they would drug me, and then he should be able to sleep. So we get there. They do a CAT scan, all that, and sure enough, they came back and said, your gallbladder needs to be taken out. I forget if it was gallstones or diseased or what.
Both,
yeah. Anyway, I'm like, thank you for the report, but no thank you. And because inside what I said is God put it there for a reason, God can heal it, and I'm going to trust Him for it. Well, things got, when you start talking about cutting me open and taking something out, it got real serious at that point. I tried to ignore it up to that point instead of truly believing and trusting in God for healing me. But see, all of a sudden, inside, a switch turned on. Like, no way, no how. And so I left, and I said, Father, I just thank You that You've healed me completely. You put it in there for a purpose. So I thank You for making it perfect and healed, and I'm not going to have this gallbladder taken out in the name of Jesus. And that's been 6 or 7 years ago, I suppose, and I've never had another problem with it since. Praise God.
Mm-hmm.
See. So what the Lord was doing out of wisdom was giving me something to connect with. Well, finally, I wake up this morning, and guess what? I'm not coughing and hacking and all of that. My temperature's back down to normal. And I'm just like, thank You, Jesus, that I'm not going to have to go through a long continuing sickness. But that whole word about Him executing judgment, I just saw God just coming in and saying, sickness, get out of my kingdom in Jesus' name. Now, the glory belongs to Him. He's the one that does it. The glory doesn't belong to me. He just helped me get in a place that I could trust Him and that I could receive from Him. See, it's the spirit of wisdom. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.